This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Good morning and welcome to Racing Across America on this Wednesday morning. I'm Seth Merrill. Thanks for joining us. A little later on, we're going to be joined by Jeremy Plant, horseplayernow.com, and Countdown to the Crown, our regular weekly visit, and look back at some of the three-year-old action from this past weekend, some very good three-year-old action. We'll also get some of his thoughts on three-year-old debut later today of Honor Code down at Gulfstream Park. A lot of attention for a Wednesday card at Gulfstream, certainly. And a little later on, John Brile. I have to check on the pronunciation of his name. We exchanged emails, so I didn't get a chance to do that. But John is the proprietor of the Tampa Bay Downs Handicapper.com website. He makes selections for Tampa Bay each and every day. So I thought we'd invite John on this morning as Tampa is racing this afternoon. We'll get some of his thoughts on the Wednesday afternoon card at Tampa, but also we'll look back with him at some of the action this past weekend down at Tampa as well, as they had a very nice stakes card down there highlighted by the Tampa Bay Derby. Yesterday down in Ocala, talked a little bit, alluded to it briefly on the handicappers report. Yesterday down at Ocala, they had the Ocala Breeders sale, 2-year-old in training sale for March, and boy, they knocked it out of the park. They set auction records in gross, average, and median. Just to give you an idea here, the gross up 31%, the average up 23%, the median up 10%. And it was a little bit funny, and I wonder if this affected things at all. It seems like it would have worked the other way, but I will be interested to read kind of a post-game comments, so to speak, from the folks down at the Ocala Breeders Company, because the sale changed up a little bit. It was scheduled to be a Monday and Tuesday sale, and that's usually the game plan. It's a 2-day sale. And it's a 2-year-old in training sale, so they were doing breeze shows last week, Thursday and Friday. But there was bad weather down there on Thursday, so they moved the breeze shows to Friday and Saturday, and subsequently then they had to leave enough time for people to look at horses and whatnot and see what they like. And so they moved the entire sale to Tuesday because the sale was supposed to be Monday and Tuesday, but they condensed it all into one day. So I'm wondering if that affected.
Join me Saturday mornings at 10 for Down the Stretch. We'll inform, analyze, and welcome in the biggest names in racing. So join me Saturday mornings at 10 for Down the Stretch, right here on the OTB Television Network.
I got it. Watch me. I got it. Hey! I got something that makes me want to shout. I got something that tells me what it's all about. I got a move that tells me what to do.
Here in upstate New York, no one provides bettors with more wagering options than Capital OTB. Our network of ranch and easy bet locations stretches from the mid-Hudson Valley all the way to the Canadian border and west to central New York. So whether you need to place a bet, fund your Capital Bets account, or watch the next big race, all the action is just around the corner. A full list of our branch and easy bet locations can be found online at CapitalOTB.com. Capital OTB, the better and most convenient choice for wagering in upstate New York.
I'm Anthony Mormino. Join me weekdays at 9 for the Handicappers Report. We'll handicap the top tracks across the country and help you prepare for the day in racing. That's the Handicappers Report, weekdays at 9, only on the OTB TV network.
And again, talking before the break about the Ocala Breeders' Sale, the March edition, two-year-old in training, and three notable horses coming out of that that attracted seven-figure sums. And a couple of those, hip number 343, a Son of Giants Causeway out of the dam, Rebridled Dreams. This one's interesting. Attracted $1.6 million. Pretty good deal for the Pinhookers in here. The Pinhookers picked this horse up at Keeneland in September for $550,000. $550,000, a few months later, $1.6 million. This horse, and again, Son of Giants Causeway out of Rebridled Dreams, worked the other day in 10.1. A sibling to JB's Thunder, nice stakes winner. Doncaster Rover, another nice stakes winner. So that one attracted a nice price from, I believe, Stone Street. It was Stone Street that picked that one up. Also, a Son of Tappet out of the dam Rum Line. That makes this one a sibling to Zazu, the really nice stakes performer from Southern California from just a few years back. This one worked in 10.2 the other day and also attracted $1.6 million. And I said this earlier on the Handicappers Report. These folks, the folks selling this one, must have been absolutely thrilled with the results over the past weekend, because attracting $1.3 million, a Son of Malibu Moon out of the dam Larry Bell. And Larry Bell also produced Kid Cruz, that big winner of the private terms on Saturday. And that clearly had to affect the price. I mean, this horse brings in $1.3 million. Now, again, there's some pretty good breeding there, and the horse did work in 10 flat last week. But the win by private terms, by Kid Cruz in the private terms, certainly had to affect the price a little bit. So there are three of the horses that attracted seven-figure sums in what was a record-breaking Ocala sale yesterday down in Florida. Some other news from the past 24, 48 hours. We mentioned this on the show yesterday, but just to confirm, David Scorton, who is the chairman of the NIRA Reorganization Board, he has been hired to head up the Smithsonian Institute. Currently, he's the head of Cornell University, as well as being the chairman of the NIRA Reorganization Board, but now moving on to the Smithsonian Institute. That doesn't take effect, however, until the summer of 2015. So we're over a year away. We'll see how this affects. NIRA's come out with a statement that said they believe he will continue to head the board with distinction, was their quote. And we'll see how it plays out. If Scorton remains with the NIRA board, if he does, I said yesterday on the show, it seems like there's a transition period which will require a lot of his attention moving out of Cornell and towards the Smithsonian. So we'll see if he sticks with NIRA and what kind of attention he can give to the NIRA board with, again, some fairly big issues facing them over the next year with the transition away from this state-run board to a more private organization. We'll see how that all shakes out. Certainly, their board meeting last week, they discussed some of these issues, and we'll see how that, again, plays out. Also, Pat Valenzuela, the Valenzuela saga continues. Pat Valenzuela went in front of the stewards out there Sunday and, again, appealed to have his license reinstated so that he can work in the industry. Valenzuela saying, however, he does not want to be a jockey anymore. His game plan now is to be an exercise rider, but he would like to be involved in the industry in some fashion, a television commentator, or he has a long-term interest in training. He says, I'm not going to ride, but I'd like to get a license and be able to work in the industry. The stewards did not grant that license this past Sunday. It was just a brief meeting, but they are taking it under consideration. So Pat Valenzuela, sounds like the riding career is over, but he does want to continue to be involved in the industry, so he's appealing to the stewards out there in Southern California to be licensed appropriately. Top Billing has had surgery. According to the Racing Form follow-up article, we're looking at perhaps 4 months on the sideline. Cracked cannon bone. According to Shug McGahee, the surgery went off without a hitch Sunday in Kentucky. McGahee said everything went perfectly. He'll stay up there in Kentucky and recuperate at Windstar. If all goes well, we can expect him back in perhaps 4 months. So we'll see how that plays out. But Top Billing, who is shaping up to be a very nice contender on the Triple Crown Trail this year. Sidelines, but again, with a fracture, now it's been repaired. Things are looking good. Should be back, hopefully, 4 months or so. We'll take charge. Wayne Lucas has said the Oaklawn Handicap is next on his schedule. Oaklawn Handicap comes up on April 12th. It's a grade two event for $600,000. And it's interesting, this article that was in the Racing Form also quotes Wayne Lucas. We've talked a little bit about the big cap over the weekend. And I said, Luis Saez, you could see We'll Take Charge was up closer to Game On Due than probably they would normally be. But it's Game On Due. They had to be watching the track, and you had to speculate. Their strategy was, listen, we got to be a little closer than maybe we want to be. And so his second place finish, I thought, was very good given the circumstances. Well, sure enough, Wayne Lucas in this article about We'll Take Charge, perhaps to Oaklawn next time, is quoted as saying, when the three-year-old race was run and California Chrome took off like that, I thought, we really have to evaluate what we're going to do. So clearly Wayne Lucas did look at the track the way it was playing out at Santa Anita on Saturday and then made some adjustments to his game plan with regards to We'll Take Charge and their strategy. And he and Mucho Macho Man not so much taken out of his game. You thought he would be up close to a Game On Due. But both of those down the backstretch were up and right off the flank pretty much of Game On Due. And for We'll Take Charge, that was probably a little bit out of his comfort zone. But again, you have to call an audible on days like that, and you can't let a horse like Game On Due get too far away or you'll never reel him in. As it turned out on Sunday, with a performance like that, weren't going to reel him in anyway. All right, we're going to head to our first break. As we do, though, I got to have a little video from Cheltenham yesterday, the end of the race two. It was the Arkell. Last week on the show, we talked to Sean Clancy. Of course, he and his brother, Joe, were for a long time publishers of the Steeplechase Times. Sean himself, a former Steeplechase jockey. Now he and Joe have the This Is Horse Racing website, as well as they continue to publish the Saratoga Special right up here in our area each summer during the Saratoga season. But Sean also a bloodstock consultant, but he also owns some horses himself under the River D Stable name. And he had a horse at Cheltenham. He came on last week and described for us a little bit about how big Cheltenham is over there in Europe on the jumping side of the game. And we had some photos of it that day. Crowds fill the stands. It has a Breeders' Cup type of a feel. It is the punctuation on their steeplechase season. 4 days of racing, and really gets the juices flowing over there in Europe in the racing community. And Clancy has been over a number of times to watch the racing live. And this year, he brought a horse over. He had a horse named Valdez, who was looked legitimate. A horse came in off a win previously, and Valdez looked pretty good coming into this. As we pick it up, you'll be able to see Valdez pretty easily here. I won't give away the finishing position. You can watch him coming under the wire. Again, this is yesterday's article. We'll pick it up maybe a minute into the race. It was a two-mile race, and Valdez, you'll pick him up because he's got a red cap and a blue and white striped vest, silks. So pretty easy to spot. The red cap, the blue and the white striped silks. Valdez is the name. Sean Clancy, we had some rooting interest there in the article yesterday. We'll watch the end of yesterday's article as we go into the break. When we come back, Jeremy Plonk, horseplayernow.com, and Countdown to the Crown. We'll talk some three-year-old action from the past weekend right after this.
Western Warhorse, to his credit, is boxing on, followed by Grand Away on the outside. A bad mistake by Ted Veal, and now a long run towards the first in the straight, which will be the second from home. Champagne Fever still clings the rail and clings to a tenuous lead. To the outside is Trifolium, but it's Champagne Fever who begins to kick off the turn. He's got a length clear once again. Trifolium now is being driven, dodging bullets, tries to get through on the inside rail, followed by Valdez, and then Western Warhorse. Here's the second from home. Champagne Fever is repelling all raiders. Trifolium on the outside. Ted Veal was a faller when beaten at the second last. Here's the final fence now. Champagne Fever in second place. Trifolium and Western Warhorse, a remarkable run, having hit a flat spot at the top of the hill. He is rallying manfully towards the near side. Champagne Fever, though, digs, racing to line. Champagne Fever and Western Warhorse. Western Warhorse may have nicked it right on the line. And if he has, it is a quite remarkable performance to win it at double digits. It was Western Warhorse and Tom Scudamore who must have got there on the line from Champagne Fever, but it will go to the judge. Tight.
The future of online betting is here, and only at the all-new CapitalOTBBet.com. CapitalOTBBet.com delivers a state-of-the-art wagering experience found nowhere else in horse racing. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
Fascinated by the world of horse racing? Interested in honing your handicapping skills? Class is in session. Night school, Monday nights. Easy to access online. It's free, interactive, and informative for the casual and serious race fan. Horse Player Now Buzz. Live horses to watch, emailed to you daily. Our eyes, your prize. Night School and the Buzz. Visit horseplayernow.com for details.
Each morning on the OTB TV network, you get the very best in horse racing programming. Weekdays begin with the Handicappers Report, where professional handicappers share their selections and analysis of the day's racing. Followed by Racing Across America, a daily conversation with racing personalities from around the country. Saturdays include Down the Stretch, where Mark Cassano speaks with the biggest names in racing. And Sunday mornings, it's Loose on the Lead, where Steve Bick and I offer news and a unique lineup of weekly guests. All here on the OTB TV network.
Funding your Capital OTB bet account is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, easy money. Clearly the fastest and easiest method of depositing funds into your account. Make deposits or withdrawals in just minutes. 2, Green Dot Money Pack gives you instant access to your funds. Green Dot Money Packs are available at thousands of retailers nationwide. And 3, MasterCard Visa. Simply click on the link from the funding page, enter your account information, and fund your account. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today. Missed one of our TV shows? No worries. Now you can catch all your favorite programs online. Simply log on to CapitalOTB.com and click on the YouTube link at the bottom of the homepage. And look for our new podcast coming soon. CapitalOTB.com. Log on today.
Welcome back to Racing Across America. Waiting now to make contact with Jeremy Plonk. Before we do that, speaking of three-year-olds, and we're going to talk a little bit about this past weekend with Jeremy, but coming up is the Rebel Stakes down at Oaklawn on the weekend, and Kobe's back. Looks like that one's going to be shipped out to Arkansas for John Sadler. Kobe's back getting a shot, grade two winning three-year-old. Kobe's back will get a shot in that Rebel on Saturday. Nice stakes card set up for Saturday down at Oaklawn, but the Rebel is one of those $600,000 purse three-year-olds in the mix there. And among those, Kobe's back, going to be one of the horses in the mix, but throw in horses like Tapiture, Strong Mandate. We're also looking at potentially Ride on Curlin, Bourbon Eyes, and Street Strategy. Certainly a very, very interesting mix setting up there in the Rebel down at Oaklawn Park on Saturday. And again, $600,000 purse, grade two event, Derby points race, shaping up to be very, very competitive down there. Also on Saturday down at Oaklawn. And these should be drawn, I'm not sure whether they're drawn today or tomorrow, but certainly by tomorrow afternoon, we will have the fields set for these weekend races down at Oaklawn. But also at Oaklawn on Saturday, the grade two $200,000 Azari, and Bill Mott is looking to send close hatches to Oaklawn for the 2014 debut. So again, it looks like a really, really nice weekend shaping up at Oaklawn on Saturday. All right, happy to be joined now by Jeremy Plonk, horseplayernow.com, countdown to the ground. Good morning, Jeremy.
Good morning, Seth. Life is good. A beautiful day here in the Northeast for once.
Absolutely, yeah. How long that is going to hold out, we don't know. And guys, I can barely hear Jeremy in my ear here. I don't know if you can turn him up, that would be helpful. And Jeremy, as always at the top of the interview, like to go back to, because last week you kicked off the night school sessions online, the nice online educational program offered by horseplayernow.com. Give us a little recap if people want to go back and visit the archive from last night.
All the archives are up, and they're accessible for free. If you go to horseplayernow.com, click on the night school page, you open up the chat box, and the very first link at the top will give you the audio stream from last night. We talked about preparing for a day at the races and everything that goes into your preparation as a horse player and budgeting your money and finding the spots that you really want to attack and how to assess the card from the time the entries come out until it's time to make a bet. Kurt Hoover from HRTV and Brian W. Spencer from the Fairgrounds were our two guests last night, And I have to tell you, Seth, I think we've done 122 night schools now. I think this was our best one. I really enjoyed the program last night, and it's something that people want to check out. Excellent roundtable discussion. Caitlin Bradar was involved as well with myself and Steve Vick, and we got a lot of good applicable tactics that you can listen to and put into use right away.
Nice. We like that. And again, folks, there's a link on the Capital OTB page, but you can also go right to straight to horseplayernow.com and pull up archives and whatnot from previous night school editions. Jeremy, let's get back into the past weekend. Certainly there was some very good three-year-old action. And as we say every week, if folks want to keep up with the three-year-olds comprehensively, every Friday you put out the countdown to the crown package. It looks ahead to the weekend of three-year-old action back at the week past. And again, if you want to keep up with the three-year-old trail, that's the way to do it. Jeremy Plonk's Countdown to the Crown. You can also find that at horseplayernow.com. Jeremy, let's kick things off. Tampa Bay Derby on Saturday. We're going to watch the stretch run and see a really nice front-running effort from the number one Ring Weekend. Vince Ramos, the number six horse who was chasing that big bonus coming off of the win in the Sam Davis down at Tampa. I thought, given the circumstances, Vince Ramos a pretty good third. Conquest Titan, the number five horse, as the 5-2 favorite, was maybe a little bit of a disappointment. But to me, given what he'd done already, that seems to be an aberration. He just may have been one who didn't quite take to that, what is a little bit of a quirky surface. I'll give Conquest Titan one more coming out of this. But Ring Weekend, interesting new player on the Derby trail from West Point.
I happen to agree with everything you said about those three particular horses. You know, I thought that the Sam Davis winner, Vince Ramos, ran a good race. I thought it was a good, credible second in there. Ring Weekend came out of nowhere off of a maiden win. You know, they were going to run at the private terms in Maryland, but because Kieran McLaughlin was sending Barati there, they thought that was too tough of a spot for $100,000, so they bit off a big chunk, and they drew the rail with a horse who really had not that much speed in his previous races. But Daniel Centeno knew that the track was playing fast. He gunned his horse to the lead from the rail, and Ring Weekend simply ran them off their feet. I mean, he really was impressive in this race. You know, the splits were fast, and he kept on going, and he drew off nicely. This is a horse who is interesting. He's a late bloomer to the deal, and Graham Motion is as good a horseman as there is in America or abroad, and so he's in great hands. In Graham we trust, I say a lot in Countdown, and I agree with that. The situation now with Ring Weekend is they move on to the Calder Derby next, is what the folks at West Point are telling me. And the Calder Derby is kind of a newer race on the Triple Crown Trail because Calder's trying to find their niche going head-to-head with Gulfstream. That Calder Derby is going to be in early April, and it's not a points race for the Kentucky Derby. And the interesting thing is here, it doesn't matter for this horse anymore. Ring Weekend picked up 50 points. He'll easily be in the Derby field. And when you have a syndicate that owns the horse, you got to remember, syndicates are selling an experience. West Point Thoroughbreds is going to sell the experience to their partners who are in this horse to get to the Kentucky Derby. So they're going to bite off the easiest race they can find that really won't matter. So the Calder Derby is a nice purse. I think it's $250,000. It's not going to matter to qualifying for the Kentucky Derby, and it's probably a race where he's not going to lose his spot in the Derby credentials. You know, he's not going to go there and run six or seven. If they try to go to the Wood Memorial and he bounces off a race like this and runs six or seven, it's hard to get people excited about going ahead and moving on to the Kentucky Derby. So selling the experience, I think picking that race at Calder is pretty smart, and it's going to almost preserve it. He's going to probably run 1, 2, 3 at Calder no matter what happens and who shows up there, and that'll give him just cause to go to the Derby, and they can sell that experience. As for Conquest Titan, the horse you talked about, he needs a big race to get into the Derby on points in his next race, but if he doesn't run 1, 2, 3 in a final prep, he's probably not a Derby horse anyway, even though he did have that good second to Cairo Prince going back in the Holy Bull. So this is a horse who gets a chance to re-earn his way in, and I think he'll get that opportunity. I believe Mark Cassie is talking about going the Arkansas Derby route with this horse. Cassie's had a string at Oaklawn this year, and I think, you know, that I would think maybe the bluegrass for Conquest Titan, who's run well in the Poly up in Canada, but I think that they are going to go the Arkansas Derby route, which we'll see after the Rebel this weekend how tough that race turns out.
And after the race, I was really interested to hear the Calder Derby was one of the options for a Ring Weekend. And I have to admit, it was floating under my radar screen. And as you say, it's not a points race. And that's what makes it a little bit interesting to me. This horse now with the 50 on the weekend has enough points in the back pocket. And I'm going to be really interested to see what that Calder Derby draws. And if maybe there's a couple other horses in there that have some points already and are just looking for a prep to, you know, down there in Florida, a prep that they can aim to. I will be very interested to see what that field winds up to be. But it's... just another piece to the puzzle now. Again, it's not a points race, but it comes on a place on the calendar. It's down in Florida. That I think that Calder Derby is going to be interesting this year.
Well, in Churchill Downs' association with Calder Racecourse, you've got a feeling this race will be a points race in the future, and it was just moved this year. And so, you know, next year you may be looking at points for the Calder Derby. I'd be shocked if it's not next year. But, I think it's a pretty smart spot, especially, again, because they're trying to sell the experience of being owners and going to the Derby. You know, Wayne Lucas talks about he goes to the sale trying to find a horse that will get an owner to the Derby. That's all he's trying to do because he knows that experience will get that owner back to the sale and buy 5, 6, 8 more horses and try to get back there again. Once you get people hooked on that Derby fever, they're in it for life.
Yeah, it will definitely be a very exciting experience for the folks at West Point. All right, let's shift our attention now out to the West Coast, the San Felipe Grade 2 event, mile and a 16th on the dirt, $300,000 purse. And Jeremy, I'm going to be interested to hear what you're planning to do with the winner as far as your top 20 list for this week, because California Chrome absolutely jumped up. We had Steve Haskin on with us on Sunday, and he alluded to it, and sure enough, when his top 20 or his Derby Dozen came out this week, he put California Chrome on top. California Chrome firing big numbers, a 107 buyer, a 109 equibase number, the best among the three-year-olds this year. We're going to watch the stretch run and a front-end performance all the way for California Chrome. He'll win it as the 7-5 favorite and do so convincingly. Well back, better than 7 lengths, is Midnight Hawk, the Bob Baffert trainee under Mike Smith. But boy, this was a very special performance from California Chrome.
Absolutely dominant. And I had to do a poll for the Louisville Courier-Journal on Sunday, and we have to get that out about an hour after the preps. And I really didn't fully soak in how good this race was at the time. I believe I ranked California Chrome 7 or 8 in that Courier-Journal poll. When the countdown's released on Friday, he's going to move up a few spots there. He will be in the top 5. A lot has to do with how Honor Code comes back today, and maybe he slides down a notch or moves up a notch. But California Chrome is going to be among the major players here. You've known for weeks I've had Candy Boy at the top of the ranks from California off his win in the Lewis. This was the best stakes performance of the year. It will be the number one ranked stakes performance in Countdown when that is published on Friday. The thing that I really like about this race from California Chrome was under the wire the first time. This horse broke like an absolute shot. You know, I mean, he just couldn't have broke any faster. He got a flyer, as Trevor Denman said. Then with about 3 strides, he was able to just get wrapped up by Victor Espinosa and come back to the jockey and relax. Typically, when horses break with the rein and just go from the starting gate, it's very tough to get them reeled back in. This horse had no problem at all taking a cue from the rider. And what was interesting was every time Midnight Hawk tried to inch up and turn the heat on, he just flicked his ears a little bit and spurted clear again. I mean, those are gears that are special. California Chrome is really coming into himself. This is a horse who's had a lot of experience, a lot of foundation. And look, last year, based on pedigree, based on his performances, you would have thought he would have been a sprinter, miler type horse. But the way he ran this race, he was strong. He hasn't had to be a front-end horse in his other races. So if he was just a speed horse who went wire to wire and won by a mile like he did in the San Felipe, you'd say, yeah, but can he rate? This horse is rated in all of his other races for the most part, you know, sat second or third and finished up well. So he's shown some versatility. He's shown the ability to relax, show speed and burst. It's everything you want to see. He cornered really nicely. There's no real knock to him at all. Now, if you do want to look at him and say, is he a mile and a quarter horse, that's where you can start to wonder just a little bit. The pedigree on the dam side should not get him a mile and a quarter, but it shouldn't have got horses like Smarty Jones the mile and a quarter either. These horses can't overcome it. And his gallop out, there really wasn't much gallop out by any of the horses in the San Felipe. They all galloped out fairly poorly after that race and were spent. So those are the only potential knocks, but I don't know how you can pick that race apart from start to finish. He looked phenomenal. He ran through the wire very strongly. So it wasn't one of those situations where he was shut down at the end or laboring at the end or drifting. He ran through the wire very strong. There was just no gallop out. that may not be a factor in the future. What you're trying to say, is he a mile and a 16th all the way to a mile and a quarter horse? That's the only question, but they're all going to have that question.
For me, the potential knock is how good the race was. And Art Sherman, yeah, after the race says, gee, we might skip the Santa Anita Derby and go right to the Kentucky Derby. And I'm going to be very interested to see what kind of a decision he makes, because you fire that big 107. It was a big effort. So how does this horse come out of that? And if they do skip the Santa Anita Derby, then you have to wonder, did this take something out of the horse? And now you're 8 weeks to the Derby. So really, how good the effort was is the question mark for me.
Well, if he skips, he's an absolute throwout to me if they were to do that. I mean, if they were to come in off of this race against four or five rivals, the second and third place finishers are milers. I think we know that now. Midnight Hawk always, rung me as a miler. Crystal, I thought, could outrun his pedigree and go a little bit longer to a mile and a 16th, a mile and an eighth, but he proved not to be that brilliant to stay with these horses at a mile, and he had no clothes or no gallop out in him to make you think he's going any further. So, no, I agree with you. He needs a galvanizing test in his next race against top-level competition. The race against Candy Boy would do them a tremendous amount of good. I think both horses would benefit from that. One runs first, one runs second, or somebody splits them in the exacta because the other one kind of got knocked out a little bit. We've seen plenty of second and third place finishers in the Santa Anita Derby come back and win the Kentucky Derby. Real quiet, Silver Charm. These horses didn't win the Santa Anita Derby. So it can happen. And so I wouldn't be afraid to bounce a little bit in the Santa Anita Derby and run second or third. You're in on points. It's not an issue for a horse like California Chrome. I think the racing is important. I think getting that extra distance to a mile and an eighth would help. And I think a galvanizing test against top-level competition would do it as well. His win over Tamarando doesn't look too bad in that state bred race prior. But if Tamarando's the best horse you've beaten going into the Derby, you've got to figure Tamarando's probably at best a 20-to-1 type horse in Louisville. So you haven't beaten any of the top 5, 6, 7 choices on the tote board all the way through the Derby. And then to do it off an 8-week layoff with a questionable dam side pedigree, I mean, he would be a complete toss-out to me if he doesn't run in the Santa Anita Derby. That said, I think he will run in the Santa Anita Derby, and if he runs a good first, second, or third, and he trains well up to the Derby, he's a legitimate contender in Louisville.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what they decide to do. All right, let's shift our attention out now to a race that I think for a lot of folks that could float totally under the radar. We picked up on it here at the show, though. We watched it on Monday. It was so compelling. That's the Private Terms out at Laurel Park. Three-year-olds, ungraded, $100,000, mile and an eighth. As you say, the West Point folks were thinking of shipping a ring weekend up here, but they didn't want to face Barati. Well, I think after the race, they probably decided Barati didn't run well, but they made the right move. We're going to pick it up going into the far turn. The number 8, Kid Cruz, I think will just be hitting your screen here. On the backstretch, Dave Rodman called Kid Cruz 25 lengths behind, and he wasn't on the television picture. But coming into the stretch, again, number 8, Kid Cruz, Julian Pimentel gets him underway, and boy, he goes back 25 lengths behind on the backstretch and goes by him like they're standing still to win off by 4. Running second, my old buddy, the number 6 joint custody, Barati, who did go off as the 8-5 favorite, winds up running a disappointing 6th in here. But again, we're seeing a big sweeping move from Kid Cruz way back in the pack to win for fun here in the private terms on Saturday.
Well, he just circled the field and swallowed him up. Came home at about 37 and change over the last 3 furlongs, I believe, when you kind of calculate the beaten length. The race came home slow on the clock for the leaders, but if you look at his individual splits and the amount of ground that he made up, they don't have trackers at Laurel. But if you kind of put the old hand calculations to it, he came home very well, 37 and change over the last 3 furlongs. In a mile and an eighth race, let's not forget, this is not a mile and a 16th or a mile and 9 furlongs. One of the first, 9 furlong dirt tests that these horses have seen this year. A very good performance, reminiscent of one we saw last year from a horse named Mr. Palmer for Bill Mott, who came down from Aqueduct, didn't have the fastest of paces, but still closed wide and won in hand and looked really strong. Mr. Palmer was a horse I got really excited for. I bet him a little bit in the futures when the pool came up and got a shot in on him and thought he might win the Wood Memorial and really had a good look at him. And he ran a decent fourth in the Wood, and it turned out to be an okay horse. Kid Cruz kind of seems a little bit in that cut. We'll see. I think he'll get that chance in the Wood Memorial. That seems like the logical next spot for him. Another spot, though, that I would look at if I was the connections with Kid Cruz, he's got some tail of the cat on the dam side of the pedigree. Those horses absolutely love Keeneland. Tail of the Cat is one of the better Polytrack sires at Keeneland. And with that running style that he has, you know, he can lag behind a slow pace. This was a very slow pace at Laurel, yet he still closed with a rush. That would fit very well definitively at Keeneland on the poly track, and he's got the pedigree to go for it. Depending who shows up, let's say Honor Code wins off by 10, you know, today, and goes to the Wood Memorial. Do you really want to go against the Honor Code in the Wood? If I've got this horse here, Kid Cruz, I'm thinking maybe the Bluegrass would be something that would be eyeballed. I haven't seen the nominations list completely. There are about 200 horses nominated to the Bluegrass. I'm not sure if he's on there. It would have to be supplemented to the race.
Yeah, interesting. And did you see that a sibling of Kid Cruz's sold for $1.3 million Ocala yesterday? Certainly they had to be very happy with the results on Saturday.
Oh, you strike when the iron's hot. I know that. You know, some folks in Pennsylvania called me a few years back, and they said, what do you know about this horse Jumpstart? We're thinking about bringing it to one of the little farms here in Pennsylvania. And I said, you know, Jumpstart was okay as a horse, but I can tell you this. He's got a horse named Rail Trip. It runs in the Hollywood Gold Cup in a couple weeks. So if you want to buy him now, because if Rail Trip wins the Hollywood Gold Cup, the price will go way up. Well, you know what happened. Jumpstart's standing in Pennsylvania right now, and they were smart to jump on him a little bit early. One win can really make a difference in the breeding shed. And like you say, Kid Cruz's brother rang up the sales total there at Ocala.
Timing is everything in life.
Absolutely.
Jeremy, one more race from the past weekend, and this was a non-stakes race, an allowance event, but could prove a little bit interesting on the Derby Trail, as this is a Ken Ramsey-owned horse for Chad Brown on the undercard at Tampa on Saturday. They're on the turf at a mile. It's Bobby's Kitten. This was the three-year-old debut. Bobby's Kitten won the Pilgrim last year, ran third in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Turf. We'll watch the stretch run here of the three-year-old debut for Bobby's Kitten, and this one wins nicely at 2-5, and as I say, may play a part on the Triple Crown Trail this year.
Oh, I think so. I've got him in the middle of my top 20. He's an 11, 12 kind of ranked horse. This was a very good two-year-old. Now, can he get a mile and a quarter on the dirt? We're not sure about that, but can he make it to the Kentucky Derby? Absolutely. He's going to go to the Bluegrass next out of this. You know Ken Ramsey, come hell or high water, he's going to have a horse in the Derby if they can get in. And so, you know, that's Ken's quest. And so Bobby's Kitten, if he can run, you know, first or second in the Bluegrass, he'll get in on points, maybe even third in the Bluegrass, depending on how the points total shakes out, might kind of get him in the discussion. So they're going to give it a whirl. I think he's a talented horse. And if he would make the Kentucky Derby, he's not going to embarrass himself. I mean, this is a horse who can finish middle of the pack in the Derby. And maybe if he progresses over the next start, the next, you know, 6-7 weeks in the morning and in his training, could be a serious contender. He's a very talented horse. I mean, this is one that they thought a lot of as a two-year-old. And I thought this was a pretty smart comeback race in this mile race on the turf. It did not come up easy, though. I mean, the runner-up in this race was the Grade 3 Generous Stakes winner for Tom Proctor. So this was a stakes-caliber field, and Bobby's Kitten handled that rival with pretty good ease. He's going to be a handful in the Bluegrass. If the track at Keeneland is anywhere favorable to front runners at all and not just, you know, collapsing the speed and a real demanding poly track on that day, he'll have a chance in that mile and an eighth Bluegrass.
Yeah, he's going to be interesting. And finally, Jeremy, only got a minute or so left, but I did want to touch on the race that's going to attract all the attention today, eighth race at Gulfstream this afternoon, three-year-old debut of Honor Code. I did the Handicappers Report a little earlier here on the network, and Gulfstream was my assignment. I put Honor Code on top, but I said, you know what, if you're playing the horizontals, if you're playing that Rainbow Six or whatever, I think you have to put Social Inclusion in, just at, you know, the speed from the rail. And, you know, this is the comeback effort for Honor Code. So top of the stretch, if Honor Code is kind of really chasing, do they really put the pedal to the metal, or, you know, they have bigger fish to fry down the road? So Social Inclusion, to me, very, very interesting in this race. What are your thoughts? And as we talk about this, just wanted to remind people, we'll watch the stretch run of last year's Remsen, where, of course, there will be that nice duel to the wire between number 4, Honor Code, number 9, Cairo Prince. Honor Code will come out on top here, going back to the last race from Honor Code before this three-year-old debut. But what are your thoughts on this afternoon's event?
Well, I agree with you 100%. Social Inclusion is the horse you have to look at for multi-race bets, because he's going to make the ticket probably worth 10 times what it would be if Honor Code wins. And Lone Speed in a short field going a mile and a 16th over that racetrack, where Honor Code is really the only other horse with any tactical pace whatsoever, and they're not going to go out and engage this horse coming off a fast sprint debut win, it is rife for an upset, and it could happen. Now, I'm contemplating putting this horse in the Buzz Report today, Social Inclusion, as a play against Honor Code. I ended up not doing it because I just think Honor Code's the better horse. And, you know, I mean, I'm not trying to be a hero and beat a 1-9 shot in our report for fans. That's not what we do about, you know, on our main horses to watch. But if I'm playing the race from a horizontal standpoint, I agree with you. I look at something like 2 Deep, and I hope I can find a single in another race that I really like around that sequence. I haven't looked at the rest of the card, to be honest with you. But in this particular race, I see that same scenario that you do, that Social Inclusion could pull the upset here on the front end. That's how you're going to beat a horse like Honor Code in a short field. It's going to be somebody stealing away loose on the lead. And from a pace projection, there's just no way to see that the rail horse isn't going to get loose here.
Yeah, we talked about it on the handicapper support. And you look at the conditions, this race was certainly written for Honor Code, but I think Social Inclusion makes it a very, very interesting race this afternoon. Jeremy.
Yeah, it makes it a good test for him, you know, and that's what you want to see.
Yeah,
it's not just like the Uncle Mo Invitational, that kind of deal like that. If Honor Code can come back and reel in a lone speed horse like that who looks good, then I think he goes right back up, but you know, right at your 1-2 list on your contenders. And,
yeah.
And he should do that today.
And good for Shug, too, with the bad news of Top Billing the other day. So hopefully we'll keep our fingers crossed. Honor Code makes a successful 3-year-old debut this afternoon. Jeremy, as always, we appreciate the visit. Again, horseplayernow.com. Countdown to the Crown. The new Countdown to the Crown column comes out every Friday, so check that out as well. Jeremy, thanks a lot. We'll talk to you next week.
Enjoy the action today. Should be fun.
Absolutely. All right, we'll take our next break. When we come back, John Barile from the Tampa Bay Downs Handicapper.com. We'll get some ideas on Tampa Bay for this afternoon. Stay tuned.
I'm Jeff Carl. Join me Saturdays and Sundays at 9 for the Handicappers Report. We'll handicap the top tracks across the country and help you prepare for the weekend in racing. That's the Handicappers Report. Weekends at 9, only here on the OTB TV Network.
Fans, head down to the all-new Clubhouse Racebook and get in the game. With live horse racing on more than 250 flat-screen TVs, state-of-the-art wagering terminals, fantastic food and drinks, an amazing Vegas-style atmosphere with seating for nearly 900 of your closest friends. Conveniently located at 711 Central Avenue, right off Exit 5 of I-90 in Albany, the Clubhouse Racebook is the better choice.
Using CapitalOTBBet.com is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, simply log on with your username and password from the homepage. 2, fund your Capital OTB account through our Easy Money, Green Dot, or Visa MasterCard options. And 3, place your bet on one of our 3 easy-to-navigate wagering platforms, Capital Bet TV, Capital Bet Express, or Capital Bet Pro. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
This is Steve Beck. Join me Tuesday through Saturday here on OTB TV for At the Races, my SiriusXM daily news magazine of the thoroughbred industry. Handicapping, interviews, analysis, everything you could want. 6 a.m. OTB TV.
Welcome back to Racing Across America. We're happy to be joined now by John Barile of the Tampa Bay Downs Handicapper.com. Good morning, John.
Good morning.
And, John, this is the first time I've had you on the show. Why don't you tell us a little bit about the website and maybe give us a little bit of background how you got into the game.
Well, I've been playing Tampa for about 30 years, and when my folks retired down there, this was something that my dad and I always were able to do together, go to the track, enjoy ourselves. And when he moved into Hillsborough County, it was just a logical thing that we would continue to play. And we played Tampa for many, many years, choosing index cards, you know, before computers. And then I was a policeman in New York City for 25 years. And when I retired to Florida, I thought, well, my wife said, well, what are you going to do with yourself? You get another job? And I said, I'm not getting a job. So I always thought that this was a tough game, and I wanted to beat it. And I set about doing everything I needed to be able to be a winner and I began the website, and we've been doing great ever since we began in 2007.
Yeah, very good. And you say you were a New York City policeman, so I'm assuming in the summertime you make some trips right up to our neighborhood in Saratoga?
I get up there. We have a family reunion at Lake George every summer, and I'm up there pretty regularly. But, you know, I enjoy the charm and the peace and the quiet of Tampa. Saratoga's a bit of a... It's like being on a crowded subway.
You got to pick your spots, though, yeah. But I know what you're talking about. I'm in the same situation, similar, let's put it that way. My dad, for years, was retired down in the Sarasota-Bradenton area, and so I would go down and visit him pretty regularly and make some regular stops up to Tampa Bay. And I'm a huge fan of the track. I think the size makes it, there's just enough little buzz there, but you have some elbow room. The racing has gotten very good here in the wintertime. Let's shift our attention now and get some thoughts on the racing for this afternoon. You've got a few for us, and again, you can get more information regarding John and his selections each and every day at the Tampa Bay Downs Handicapper.com. But John, today's thoughts will start in race number 2. It's a maiden event, 10 to 12,500 tags. These are three-year-old fillies going 6 furlongs. What were your thoughts in the second race?
Well, I should start off by saying, you know, that essentially I handicap trainers and not so much horses. I mean, naturally, there are times when I handicap the horses only, other times when I handicap the trainers only, and the intersection of those two is where you get your best plays. But, you know, my records tell me that Gerald Bennett has a very high strike rate with fastbacks and shorten-ups, and this is one of them. He's 4-for-7 in the money trying that this season. And this horse made an above par early pace number before tiring at 7 furlongs, shortens up today. This is Jerry Bennett's MO, and everything looks like a go to me.
All right, so in the second race, we're looking at number 7, Gems Pride, on the trainer shortening up angle, 5-1 on the morning line, so a little juice there, nice little price. Let's look out at the 7th today. It's an optional claimer starter allowance, 8,000 in the optional claiming condition, 5 in the starter allowance condition. They're going a mile and 40. And, John, while we talk here, we're going to go back and look at a race down at Tampa going back to February 28th, because I know a horse that you like in this race today raced in that one, and that's number 5 in the race we look at, Rasta Friend. Today, Rasta Friend is the number 2 horse. But in this race we're about to watch, we're going to see the stretch run. It will be number 5, Rasta Friend, has the lead and just gets caught to run second. So, again, we're going to watch here the number 5, Rasta Friend. You like Rasta Friend again today in the 7th race. Go right ahead. We're just watching, but you can continue the commentary on Rasta Friend.
All right, then. And once again, we've got another angle play with Dennis Ward here. Ward had 70% in the money with fastback and drop down, and was 4-for-5 in the money this season with the angle. And last time out, and I make my own Kierans. I don't use any... anybody else's numbers, but my par for this race is 100 and 100, and Rasta Friend went a big 107-102 while just missing. So once again, I think that Rasta Friend and none of the other horses in this race, let me just look quickly, none of them can touch the Kierans that Rasta Friend made in that last race. Now, whether we'll see that again or not, yet to be seen, but Dennis Ward has a record of getting it done, and getting it done again.
All right, so in the 7th race, number 2, Rasta Friend. Now let's shift our attention out to the 9th race today. Optional claimer, claiming tags 75,000, non-winners of one other than the condition. These are 3-year-olds. They're going to go 6.5. And again, we got a race to watch here while we talk, John. We're going to look at Monmouth back on June 23rd. We're going to look at the career debut of the horse you like in here, Meadowood. And Meadowood wins that debut effort June 23rd up at Monmouth. Has been off since then. Interesting, though, this is a horse that in the debut effort that we're going to watch here, Meadowood, the number one horse, gets it done under Joe Bravo for Todd Pletcher. Now in the barn of Derek Ryan, but owned by some pretty potent connections, George Bolton and Stone Street. We certainly remember them from Rachel Alexandra and other good ones. Talk a little bit about, while we watch this debut effort from last summer, Meadowood today.
Well, the thing that caught my eye about Meadowood, and of course I'll begin with the trainer angle, Derek Ryan, 8-13 with right back plus up and class types at the last three meetings. Very potent numbers there. 8-13 win and 10-13 in the money. Now, a couple of weeks ago, Ryan and Stone Street had another Handy Maiden winner, Joe Tess, by Macho Uno. And he looked just like this one, same background. And sure enough, Joe Tess was a Handy winner, and he came right back. And now I see, this looks like a private sale, but Stone Street and Bolton, a 7-7 in the money in 2014, they've got average earnings per start of $58,000. You mentioned one horse. They had, you know, the BC Philly, My Miss Aurelia, a couple of years back. And I'm thinking there's nothing to stop this Ryan piece from winning right back today.
Very good. We're looking at 7-2 on the morning line, so a little bit of value if that holds up. I wonder what those connections will it hold, but even in that vicinity, the horse is interesting to me as well. Ronnie Allen on board. You talked about the trainers. Any jockeys standing out to you this season down at Tampa? Certainly Ronnie Allen went through a very good beginning of the meet. It was De La Cruz, obviously. Then when he got hurt, he's come back and he's doing pretty nicely. Gallardo, to me, last maybe 3 weeks or so has stood out a little bit as well. Do you look at any of the jocks as you're handicapping?
Well, I was surprised by how well Quincy Hamilton came and did. And this kid, Oriana Rossi, is always right there. Most of her horses alive. She has a tendency to ride very wide, but once in a while she'll get in the right place. And if she doesn't lose that one length, you know, being wide, she can win regularly.
And John, let's just go back to the weekend. Were you over Tampa on Saturday?
I wasn't. I wish I was, but I wasn't, unfortunately.
I was just wondering, because I'm wondering what kind of a crowd they had, because, boy, it was a really nice day of racing. But just before we let you go, give us your opinion on the Tampa Bay Derby and the performance by Ring Weekend.
Well, it was, you know, last week, and the weather's been horrible all winter, and that's one of the reasons why I haven't been traveling much. Last week we had 3 inches of rain on Thursday, and on Friday we had a golden rail, and Saturday we had a golden rail. The outside tends to get deep and heavy when it dries first. The inside tends to hold the moisture and stay fast. And so a Ring Weekend, he ran in a slightly above par number, but had that inside trip and had the bias with him. And looking at the last three derbies, all of them went par. And, you know, he stole off. I think that Vince Ramos clearly had the better race. And I'm surprised that there was a lot of people were surprised that Ring Weekend pulled it off. But I would expect to see Ring Weekend finish up the track like Verrazano and Prospective when he gets to the Derby. I'm not expecting much.
Interesting. All right, John, we certainly appreciate the visit. And again, your website, the Tampa Bay Downs Handicapper.com. If folks want more information, they can certainly go there. John, again, we appreciate the visit this morning. Good luck with the selections this afternoon. And certainly we'll talk to you again sometime down the road.
Thanks for having me. Have a good day. Good luck.
You too. John Burrell from the Tampa Bay Downs Handicapper.com. Just before we let you go, wanted to pull up the Watchmaker Watch, the weekly divisional ratings. As always, I pull these up the first few days of the week. Just it's interesting, the Watchmaker Watch is Mike Watchmaker. It's one man's opinion, but it's interesting to see how he shifts around. He looks at all the various divisions that essentially are Clips divisions, but rates the top 10 in each of those divisions. And after a big weekend of stakes action, I'm always interested to see how his lists get shaken up a little bit. And under older males, Game On Dude moves up from number 8 to number 2 on the watchmaker list. No surprise there off of that very big performance. I think he's indicating a mindset of a lot of fans out there. There certainly was some concern, consternation about the direction Game On Dude may have been going at a little bit of a later date in his career, but he absolutely validated he's back. And so moving up to number 2, no surprise. Watchmaker number 1 on his older male list is Wise Dan. We mentioned yesterday Wise Dan back in training at Keeneland and looking for a Keeneland debut to the 2014 season. And then going out to, I'll stick on the older male list. Mucho Macho Man, on the disappointing performance on the weekend, moves down for Mike Watchmaker. Mucho Macho Man had been number 2 last week, goes to number 5. But more surprising to me, Palace Malice had been number 6 last week, goes to 8. How does Palace Malice lose ground? That one was a little bit of a concern to me. Game On Dude moving up the way he did, I have no problem with. But Palace Malice off the nice effort moving down 2 spots was a little bit of a confusing move to me. Under the 3-year-old males, California Chrome, and again, he's reflecting the mindset of, it seems like, a lot of pundits. As I watch these Derby lists, the Derby dozens and Derby tens and whatnot that have been coming out the past couple of days, California Chrome attracting a lot of attention. California Chrome appears on the top 10 of 3-year-old males for Mike Watchmaker, makes his first visit at number 4, had not been off. And the comment under the edition of California Chrome, his San Felipe was a wow exclamation point performance. And I think, again, he's echoing the sentiment of a lot of folks after the weekend. California Chrome appearing pretty high up a lot of these Derby lists. All right, we'll wrap things up for Racing Across America for this Wednesday morning. We're here every Monday through Friday from 9 until 10 a.m. This morning, again, John Burrell from the Tampa Bay Downs, handicapper.com. Earlier, Jeremy Plonk from horseplayernow.com and Countdown to the Crown. That wraps things up for this edition. A little earlier, Anthony Mermino and I were taking a look at Tampa and Gulfstream via the handicapper support. Hopefully, we gave you some good information. Cash some tickets this afternoon. Enjoy the racing, particularly that 8th at Gulfstream today, the return of Honor Code. And we'll see you again here tomorrow morning.
You're watching OTB TV, a service of Capital Off-Track Betting.